The title of this course is Linear Algebra Foundations to Frontiers. What we would like to do is already give you a glimpse at the frontier in this first week. The frontier we're going to show you is how we, as part of our FLAME project here at the University of Texas, encode algorithms in code. Now, our philosophy is that the algorithm should be expressed in code as much as possible in a way that reflects how one thinks about the problem. So, in the last unit, we showed how to think about the algorithm in terms of subvectors. What we're now going to show you is how to represent that in code in terms of subvectors. Let's have a look. Here is the dashboard for your Python notebooks. And what I would like for you to do is open up 1.6.3 Programming Without Indices for Dot Product. Now, the first thing we always do is to make a copy. So let me go ahead and make a copy. All right. Now, in this notebook, if you read through it, the first thing we do is we create vectors x and y as matrices. And then we reiterate the simple routine that we wrote in an earlier unit that computes the dot product of x and y, outputting the result as alpha. So let's execute that box, and then let's just test that this actually does what it's supposed to do. What we're going to introduce you to next is how we now encode this in a way that very closely resembles this algorithm as we expressed it in the last unit. Let's put this algorithm on the side here so that we can look at it as we code. And let me just move this over a little bit. And now we have the algorithm on the left. And what we would like to do is create code that very closely resembles this algorithm on the left, but in Python code. Now, how are we going to do this? Okay, this is where the magic starts. What we're going to do is visit a web page that we call the Spark web page. And that web page is going to help us code the algorithm on the left in a way that closely mirrors that algorithm, but in Python. So let's click on this. And what we have now is a menu. And we're going to focus first on the part on the left. And I strongly suggest that you follow along as we do this. Let me make this a little bigger so that you can see what's going on. The first thing we need to do is give the routine that we're going to write a name. So we're going to call it dot, and let's make sure that we use lowercase letters here. The type that we're going to implement is called unblocked. Now, what unblocked versus blocked means, we'll see later. So let's just leave this as unblocked. The variant number has to do with the fact that there are often many different algorithms that compute the same operation. So we could have numbered these. For the moment, we're going to leave this as none. Now, how many different operands are involved in a dot product? Well, there's the vector x, there's the vector y, and there's the scalar alpha that is the result. So that means there are three. And what we get is we get a menu for the different operands that are going to be passed in. Now, the first operand we would like to be x, the second operand y, and the third operand is going to be alpha, which in this menu we pick as alpha. Now, x is a vector, y is a vector, and a is a scalar, and that's going to make it show up as alpha. X and y are merely inputs. We're not going to change those vectors. And alpha, or a, is going to be both input and output, because that's how we work. The output language we pick as FLAMEPy, which is an application programming interface that we have created on top of Python. What this exactly means will become clear as we move on. Now, if you want, you can go and put your name in here and your email. I'll just put in my name because I really don't want you people to email me. There are just too many of you. I'm sorry. And then comes a very important part, which has to do with how we march through the vector. Now, if we focus on the algorithm on the left here, what we notice is that x is being partitioned into a top part and a bottom part, and the same for y. When we start, x top has no components, zero elements, and when we're finished, x top consists of the entire vector. So what this means to us is that we march through this vector from top to bottom as we compute. So over here, for vectors x and y, we choose to go from top to bottom. T arrow b means top to bottom, and the same for y. So as we were filling out this menu, on the right, we ended up with an implementation in Python. Now, if you take that implementation and you put it next to the algorithm, you notice some similarities. Let's see if we can move this all the way here, and we can put this next to each other. In the algorithm, we start by saying that x needs to be partitioned into a top part and a bottom part, and the same for y, where x top and y top have no components initially. Over here, we do the same thing with a subroutine call, where we have the flame package. And the flame package has a routine that takes a vector x and partitions it into a top part and a bottom part, where this here indicates that the top part of x initially has zero components. That means that x, the bottom part of x, is all of x. Same thing for x. In the algorithm, we next check whether x top has as many components as x, because then we're finished. On the right, we do the same thing by extracting the shape, the row and column dimension of x top and x, and comparing the row dimension and to see whether we're done. Next, we have a routine that takes the top and bottom part and peels one element off of x bottom and renames the subvectors x0, chi1, and x2. And the same thing for y. That corresponds to this repartition that we have on the left. At the bottom of the algorithm, we say, continue by redefining x top to consist of x0 and chi1, and the same thing for y top, y0 and psi1. On the right, we have a routine that says, take the middle element, chi1, add it to the top, and call that x top. x2 becomes x bottom. So we have a way of implementing this continue with that we have in our algorithm. Okay, so what do we do? We highlight all of this code, we copy it, we take it over here, we insert it into this box where it says insert code here. And now there are a couple of things that we need to do. Over here, it also says that alpha must be set to 0. So what we need to do over here is set alpha equal to 0, except that we're passing alpha in as a matrix. So what we really should do is set the 0, 0 element of that matrix to 0. And then that web page doesn't really know what operation you're trying to implement. So right here, what we need to do is look and see what update must be done to alpha. And then we need to insert that right here. So we're going to say alpha of 0, 0, because we want to actually overwrite that element in the matrix, is equal to chi1 times psi1 plus alpha 0, 0. Okay, now we need to execute this block, this cell. So we do that. And then here we have a cell in which we have code that tests to see whether we get the right answer. What's happening here? Alpha is first declared as a matrix that's 1 by 1 with the element -1 in it, just to give it some value. It then calls the dot routine, which should override alpha with the dot product of x and y. And then it compares here the result to what we would compute if we did x transpose times y. So let's execute that cell. And what we find is that we get the right answer. Welcome to the wonderful world of how we program in the Flame Group. What we actually do is we code in C, and we've actually written libraries that have hundreds of thousands of lines of code this way. These codes are highly reliable because it's very difficult to make errors the way we code. And they actually tend to also achieve very high performance, and how they achieve high performance we'll talk about later in this course.